Welcome, Dr. M here. We are going to talk about addition reactions across alkenes. After you add across the alkene, the double bond will be converted to a single bond. And one example of such an addition is regioselective addition of HX, X being a halogen, either chlorine, bromine, or iodine. This reaction here is called hydrohalogenation. So it's hydrohalogenation because you're adding a hydrogen and you're adding a halogen at the same time, following Markovnikov rule. Markovnikov rule states that in an addition reaction of a protic acid like HX to an alkene or alkyne, the hydrogen atom of the acid becomes bonded to a carbon atom that has the greatest number of hydrogen atoms in the starting alkene or alkyne. Too much of text there, but this is what it means. Whenever you're adding HX, X being Cl, Br, I, the hydrogen goes to the sp2 carbon of the alkene, this one here, that is least substituted or that has more hydrogen atoms. If you compare these two sp2 carbons, this one has no hydrogens on it. That means it's mostly substituted, it's mostly functionalized. Well, this one has one, so this is the one that has more hydrogen atoms. It should receive the hydrogen from the HX, and this one will receive the X, the chlorine, the bromide, or the iodine. And that's regioselectivity, because the hydrogen ends up on one specific region, the X ends up on one specific region. In this case, you're going to end up with two products, okay? Because the alkene is planar, the addition could happen from the top face or the bottom face, and that's how you end up with these two guys. So we show stereochemistry. Going ahead to reactions, questions. It says fill in the missing reaction components. You need to show stereochemistry where possible using wedged or hashed bonds. You need to indicate the major and minor products. So in this reaction, as I said, using Markovnikov rule, the first thing you want to determine is identify your two sp2 carbons participating in the reaction and determine which one has most hydrogens. That's where the hydrogen of the acid goes. In this case, the acid is HBr, and Br will end up to the other carbon that you left that has least hydrogens on it. So the first addition is to grab the hydrogen. The pi bond is used to grab the hydrogen. So if the hydrogen ends up here where there's more, the other carbon will be left one valent electron less. So you have to put a plus charge on there. So you put a plus charge here. So H ends up here, plus charge ends up there. After you get it, now you have to determine what type of carbocation you got. This is a carbocation intermediate because it has a carbon with a plus charge, so it's called a carbocation. It's tertiary. Why tertiary? Because the carbon bearing the plus charge is bonded to three other carbons, that carbon, this carbon, and this carbon. So it's tertiary. It's more stable than secondary, and secondary is more stable than primary carbocation. So usually after you make a carbocation intermediate, you have to check and see if shifts are necessary. Because it's as stable as it can be in its structure, we'll leave it there. Remember, whenever you're doing your addition, the bromide left, the bromide will come back to attack the positive central carbon because it has electrons to give. Opposite charges attract. That's why this bromide will act as a nucleophile, because it's loving a nucleus. The nucleus is positively charged. So this is an electrophile. The carbocation is an electrophile because it loves to receive electrons. It's receiving electrons from the bromide, making a bond. A bond is two electrons. This arrow is a bond trying to form, and this bond formed here. That's the only product Remember, this carbon is symmetrical, it's not asymmetric, so no need to show stereochemistry right there or here where the hydrogen ended up, because you have two methyls of same type. You have two hydrogens which are the same type, so no stereochemistry. For you to show stereochemistry, you should have four different groups around the carbon. R1 should not be equal to R2, R2 should not be equal to R3, and R3 should not be equal to R4, where the R's are just the substituents around the carbon. This time we have a symmetrical alkene. We're still going to expect only one product, because after we add the bromide, we have similar two methyls, we have similar two methyls after we add the hydrogen, so it doesn't matter. Markovnikov rule here should not really apply, because there's no hydrogen on this sp2 carbon, there's no hydrogen on this sp2 carbon, so whichever place you want to put your H and Br, you're still correct. So again, pi bond is used to grab the hydrogen of the acid, and the Br leaves, and because this carbon, according to our choice, this carbon receives the hydrogen in red, the other carbon should be one electron less. That's why we're showing a plus sign there. One valent electron less, that's why you're showing a plus sign there. And then the Br that left to come back to attack the positively charged carbon of the carbocation. It's still tertiary, no need to do shifts. Then you get this product. The green arrow is gonna form a bond here. All right, again, no need to show stereochemistry, because you have two methyl groups which are the same type here and there. Remember, your hydrogen is there, it's just not shown. Usually organic chemists don't like showing hydrogens where they get a chance not to show. So that's the only product. Next question. You do have two hydrogens on this sp2 carbon and one hydrogen here. So these carbons are that should receive the H from the acid, according to Markovnikov rule, and this carbon next door will receive the plus sign. So that's what we've done. The hydrogen from the acid is what I'm trying to illustrate as in blue in color, and the plus sign will be there. That forms a secondary carbocation, and the Cl should leave. So you get the Cl here. Now the secondary carbocation is not as stable as it can be, so we need to move a group next door from the most substituted carbon neighboring the C+. This is the C+. The neighboring carbons is this and that. This is the most substituted because it has fewer hydrogens. So to get the most substituted carbocation, you move a group from the most substituted neighboring carbon bonded to the carbocation C+. Now we have to decide which group moves, the methyl, the hydrogen, or the propyl. To move items, it's easier to move the lighter ones. So a molecule reason to move the hydrogen and not any of these other two groups, the methyl or propyl, because it will use less energy to move the hydrogen. So you shift it with the bond. It's a 1-2 migration, because from one carbon to the other, it's 1-2 hydrogen shift because you're moving the hydrogen. So you're simply exchanging position between the hydrogen and the plus sign. You're going to get this structure, which is now tertiary carbocation. Why tertiary? Because the C+ is now bonded to three other carbons. That carbon, that carbon, that carbon. So it's tertiary and more stable, because the alkyl groups will donate electrons through bond to delocalize the plus charge around the structure by inductive effect or hyperconjugation. If you floating right now about carbocations, check the link under this video to review everything about carbocations. Now remember, you lost the Cl minus here, so the Cl minus that left comes to attack the C+ that you formed on the most stable carbocation. And the other concept is you need to realize that the carbocation itself is sp2 hybridized, because you have three groups around it, so it has to be sp2 hybridized. And since it's sp2 hybridized, it has to be planar It has to have a planar geometry around it. So an approaching nucleophile like Cl minus here could attack from the top face or bottom face. And if it attacks from the bottom face, that's what the structure you get. This metal will be flashed up. If the Cl attacks from the top face, then you get this structure and the metal will be flashed down. Equal chance of attack top and bottom, 50-50% equal yield, we call that a racemic mixture. And because the two structures only differ in one asymmetric center, we call that enantiomers. Alright? The good thing with the video, you can pause and play back and listen to me explaining again until you get it. Now, with it, this question, again, you're looking at the two sp2 carbons, you're trying to judge which one has more hydrogens. Obviously none has more hydrogen than the other, so McCormick rule won't help you. And in this case, you will just have a preference of putting a plus sign close to the more substituted carbon so you can make a more stable carbocation by a shift. So I'll prefer to put a plus charge here, and to do so, I'll prefer to put the hydrogen of the acid right there, so the plus sign will come here. And that's why I'm putting it, the hydrogen of the acid here in red. The plus sign ends up here. You get a secondary carbocation. And you check the more substituted neighboring carbon. If you can do a shift from it, yes, this is tetrasubstituted carbon. This is only monosubstituted. So we need to do a shift from this more substituted neighboring carbon. And we shift the methyl. You're trying to exchange positions between the methyl in blue and the plus sign. You're going to get this structure, and this is now a tertiary carbocation. This is a tertiary carbocation, and it's more stable than the secondary carbocation that you got before. Usually in shifting, you only shift once, you don't keep on shifting. Now, since we lost Br here after the addition of HBr to make the carbocation, the Br is still in the flask, playing around in the solvent, in the solvent medium. It's going to attack the plus, the positively charged carbon, either from the top face or bottom face, because again, this carbon is sp2 hybridized and planar. So it can approach from either side, equal chance from the top or bottom. Just pretend this molecule is sitting on top of your desk. You could attack from the top face or the bottom face. You get these two possible answers. This one's obtained when the Br attacks from the top. The metal will be flashed back to give way because of valency shell electron repulsion theory. And then this one is where the bromide attacks from the bottom, flashing the metal up. You get enantiomers and racemic mixtures. All right. Next question. Same concept here. Markovnikov rule applied. But since the two carbons have equal number of hydrogens, you can't really decide. But the main thing is to envision what you'll get if you put a plus sign here. The plus sign can be stabilized by resonance from the ring. And it's gonna be benzylic. If you do the other way, the plus sign will be there. It's just going to be secondary and not benzylic. But this is secondary and benzylic, which means can be stabilized by resonance, which is a good thing. That's the most stable carbocation. This is the most likely carbocation to be formed from this particular reaction, because the carbocation formed here is mostly stabilized by resonance through space. You lose the chloride after the addition. The chloride will come to attack again, either from the top face or bottom face. You get these structures, equal mixture, and enantiomers. So you need to show stereochemistry, because again, you have four different groups there and there. Easy, easy. Next question. In this example, just like in E, just the previous example just finished, you want to put a plus charge here so it can sit next to the more saturated carbon, so you can do a shift. And after do a shift and exchange the plus charge to end up here, you'll end up with a dibenzylic carbocation stabilized twice by resonance. You want that to happen. So you don't want the plus charge to come here. So in that case, we're going to grab the hydrogen using the pi bond. So we put the hydrogen onto this carbon, and the plus charge will go there, following the explanation I just gave, the reason I just gave. Once you do that, you're going to get a secondary carboca town. The carboca town is not as happy as it can be. It's not yet benzylic. So you look to the most saturated carbon bordered attached to the C plus. It's going to be this carbon, and ask yourself which group you want to move. That's a question the molecule asks itself. I'm going to move the CH3 drawn in blue, which is just this methyl group here in this original structure in the question. Do a methyl shift. Do 1-2 methyl shift. You're going to get either this structure or that structure. Remember, this carbocation is planar, so once you do your shift, the shift could either occur from the top face or bottom face. If the methyl attaches from the bottom face, you get this structure here of the tertiary dibenzylic carbocation. If the shift of the methyl happens on the top face, it's gonna happen on this tertiary. It's gonna give you this tertiary benzylic carbocation. Now, during the addition of the hydrogen, you lost the chloride, right? So the chloride will come back to attack the plus sign. So it either attack this molecule, or the chloride will decide to attack. Or the chloride will decide to attack that molecule, and that's how you get these two products. Remember, this carbon here and that carbon there is not asymmetric, so we don't show the wedges. We just show use the regular straight lines. But these guys are enantiomers based on the stereochemistry that you got during the shift, and both compounds, this pair of enantiomers, is gonna be a major than these other compounds that you form if the secondary carbocation did not rearrange and the chloride decides to attack it. You're gonna get these two products where the chloride attacks from the top face to get that second molecule, or the chloride attacks from the bottom face to get the second molecule. But this will be enantiomers, and this pair is gonna be the minor products, and this pair will be the major product. All right, look at it over and over again. Remember, the same molecule will not come to your test, but the concept I'm giving you here is gonna be repeated. The reasoning is the same. You just have to use your third organic eye. What if you're asked to draw a mechanism to show how this ring was reacted to HCl to form this ring? This is a different kind of a carbocation intermediary you have to go through. You see, you're moving from a 4-membered ring to a 5-membered ring, and that this reaction will do so because it wants to relieve the ring strain you have in 4-membered ring compared to the strain that you have in 5-membered ring. Small rings are so strained. They are uncomfortable, and they want to be comfortable by expanding. So we apply Markovnikov rule because you're reacting between, it's a reaction between an alkene and a HX acid, HCl in this case. So the hydrogen of the acid should end up where there's more. This here, this carbon has two hydrogens, this has none. So the hydrogen of the acid should end up on this carbon drawn in black. And the hydrogen for the acid is this guy drawn in purple for illustration purposes, and that means the other carbon should have a plus sign. That's what you get. This is a tertiary carbocation. It is a tertiary carbocation. It's as stable as it can be, but in this case, it's one of the few cases that molecules will want to form secondary carbocation just to relieve the ring strain. So the bond in blue is gonna stretch out to attach the plus sign, and the plus sign will come there where the bond was attached. Okay, so that's how you expand the ring to get a 5-membered ring. Now, since during the first step, the slow step, you're forming a chloride, you're losing a chloride, the chloride is still in the flask. It's gonna come back to attack that positive center. You get the chloride there. All right, so refresh your mind. See how the arrows are pushed. Practice. You will be good in these things and pass your course. Thank you. See you soon. Bye.